Thank you. Can I welcome everybody to the first meeting of the Justice Committee of 2016 and wish everybody a Happy New Year, of course. I can remind people to switch off their mobile phones and other electronic devices. Christine Graham has sent her apologies, as unfortunately she's unwell today. And item one is a decision to take business in private on item eight, which is on the work programme, which requires a bit of additional consideration, and I wonder if I can get members' agreement to take that in private.
Agreed.
Thank you. The first item of business today is the consideration of one affirmative instrument, the Draft Public Appointments and Public Bodies, etc., Scotland Act 2003, Treatment of Community Justice Scotland as a Specified Authority, Order 2016. I welcome to the meeting Paul Wheelhouse, Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs. Good morning. And the Scottish Government officials, Ingrid Roberts, Community Justice Division, and Caroline O'Malley, Directorate for Legal Services. And can I remind people that officials can take part in this item, but not in the formal debate that follows. Minister, do you wish to make an opening statement?
I would, if that's possible, Deputy Convener. Well, Happy New Year, Deputy Convener, and members of the committee. I'm glad to first boot the committee today. I thank the committee for inviting me to speak to this order, which has been placed to ensure that the appointments to Community Justice Scotland will be regulated by the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland. As I stated when I wrote to the committee on the 16th of November, I believe it's important that the new body should be a regulated body, and the Community Justice Bill makes provision for that. As set out in the accompanying documents to the Community Justice Scotland Bill, it's my intention that the new body will be established in autumn 2016 and take up its full powers in April 2017, subject, of course, to the will of Parliament. In order to have the chair in place in 6 months prior to the body taking on its full functions and in line with the Audit Scotland recommendations on establishing and merging public bodies, I wish to appoint a chair as soon as possible after the bill receives royal assent, in the event that it is passed by Parliament, and the chair will then be in place to assist in the appointment process for the Chief Executive and the board members prior to the body taking on its full functions in April 2017. I believe that it's important that the appointment of the first chair and board, which will have responsibility for setting the agenda for our new lead body for community justice, is fully transparent and subject to the high quality of external scrutiny which the Commissioner can provide. Addition of Community Justice Scotland to the schedule of the Public Appointments and Public Bodies, etc., Scotland Act 2003 follows recent precedent when setting up new public bodies. The Commissioner cannot officially regulate the appointments until the body is added to the list of regulated bodies under Public Appointments and Public Bodies, etc., Scotland Act 2003 by the Community Justice Bill. That will happen when the relevant provision of the bill comes into force. However, until then, this order will enable a representative from the Commissioner's office to provide assistance during the early stages of the recruitment until subsection 3 order is in force and it can be fully regulated. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. Can I invite questions from members, please? I think the only thing that sort of stood out really was that we were passing an order for a body which hasn't yet been established. However, I think you've explained the reasons for needing to do that at this point.
There have been a couple of precedents I'm aware of. The Historic Environment Scotland and Revenue Scotland also followed a similar procedure in establishing a shadow board in advance of the legislation being passed.
Thank you. We'll move on to the formal debate on the motion to approve the instrument, and I invite the Minister to move motion S4M 14967, that the Justice Committee recommends that the Draft Public Appointments and Public Bodies, etc., Scotland Act 2013, Treatment of Community Justice Scotland as Specified Authority, Order 2016, be approved.
Formally moved, Convener.
Any members wishing to make any points? So the question is that motion S4M 14967 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I suspect that's a first order to be agreed in 2016. So.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. Suspend. Thank you. We now move on to an evidence session on the Scottish Government's draft budget 2016-17. We previously agreed to focus our budget scrutiny on three areas of spend: policing, the Fire and Rescue Service and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. Before the budget documents was published, we issued a call for views and took evidence on the financial planning being undertaken in these areas in order to inform the session today. Can I welcome to the meeting and wish a happy new year to Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Justice, and Scottish Government officials, Neil Rennick, Director of the Justice Directorate, Don McGilvray, Deputy Director of the Communities Directorate, and John Nicholson of Safer Communities Directorate. Cabinet Secretary, do you wish to make an opening statement?
I'd like to wish the committee a very happy new year.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to propose that we split the discussion into three areas. We do the police first, then the Fire and Rescue Service, then the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service to just hopefully structure things first. So can I first of all invite members' questions on the police budget, Gil and John and Roddy and and John Finney? We've got
Thank you, Convener.
Gil, followed by John Finney, followed by Roddy, followed by Margaret.
Here, Mr. Cabinet Secretary. The draft budget for 2016-17 seeks to maintain in real terms the current levels of resource funding for the SPA. How much additional funding does this actually involve?
You're correct in saying that. Increase in funding which that will provide for Police Scotland in the 2016-17 budget is just over £17 million of additional resource.
Does the additional funding for the SPA indicate a departure from previous efficiency savings, or will the services still be charged to try and maintain and look at how they can save, or are they off the hook in that regard?
Well, it'd be fair to say that Police Scotland and the SPA have already achieved a significant level of savings, recurring savings, over the last 2.5 years. And there still continues to be a requirement to make further savings and efficiencies within the organisation going forward. And this isn't a departure of recognising the need to make sure that they are continuing to seek and achieve these savings effectively. But what it does is it provides them with the level of resourcing which I believe will assist them in being able to continue to take forward the important work that they're undertaking in a range of different areas. So, for example, the additional challenges which they face around matters relating to counter-terrorism will assist them in actually meeting some of these additional demands. But the requirement for Police Scotland and SPA to continue to identify efficiencies and savings remains, and we'll be continuing to work with them to ensure that that's progressed.
Is there an expectation that there will still be efficiency savings? I know that we've heard that the pips are beginning to squeak, as I say, but is there an expectation from the government that this can be achieved?
Well, I think you've heard in the evidence already that there is still scope for efficiencies to be found. There's no doubt that when you bring forward, or you bring together eight different legacy forces, that there are always going to be significant areas of overlap and where efficiencies can be gained. And I don't believe that they have all been realised as yet. There are still areas of bureaucracy which I think could be alleviated, and there are areas where further gains can be maintained. Part of the purpose behind the Deputy First Minister agreeing to a further provision of the reform budget, which has also been provided in this particular budget, is to assist Police Scotland in taking forward some of the investment which is necessary to support them in achieving some of these efficiencies well. So I'm of the view that there are, of course, efficiencies that still can be achieved. And what we need to do is to support them and assist them in being able to do that, whether it be in ICT or in other areas around procurement, where they have already gained significant efficiencies, but where further work could be achieved. To, for example, working in collaboration with other public sector organisations and how they're purchasing particular issues and how they go about achieving procurement arrangements. These are areas where there's still significant scope for efficiencies to be saved, and there's a clear desire on the part of the SPA and also Police Scotland to make sure they continue to focus on these matters and bear down on them in order to maximise the savings that can be achieved, that they are achieved. Mm-hmm.
It's kind of strange that here we are under pressure from budgets, and that yet there's this difficulty with VAT, and maybe you could answer in regards to both services, because we are constrained for time. So what is the government, the Scottish Government, doing to try and resolve this situation where VAT is administered in Scotland with the fire service and the police service, but not down south of the border?
Well, I've made it very clear to this committee before, it's entirely unacceptable that Police Scotland and the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service are the only two services in the UK in policing or in fire and rescue services which are having to pay VAT. I know the committee have expressed some concerns about that in the past as well. We have continued to make representation to the UK government on this matter, and we've been unable to make progress, any further progress in this issue as yet. This is costing Police Scotland in the region of around £25 million a year, our Fire and Rescue Service around £10 million a year. And of course, there are those who would argue that, you know, you were warned about this before the reforms took place. And I don't deny that those warnings were highlighted by some individuals. And that given that we've gone to national services for both of these organisations, that they no longer qualify for VAT exemption. If that is the case, then I don't understand why the National Crime Agency, a UK-based agency, gets VAT exemption. I'd understand why academy schools in England were allowed to be given VAT exemption, even though they're centrally funded as well. The PSNI in Northern Ireland and their fire service get VAT exemption. They're nationally funded organisations. So if there's a political will for it to happen, it's very clear it can happen. And I think it's entirely unacceptable that we continue to be in a position in Scotland where we are spending something in the region of £35 million a year to pay VAT to Her Majesty's Treasury, where at the stroke of a pen, they could change that, and that's money that could be better invested in public services here in Scotland, including in fire and rescue services.
Is there anything the Scottish Government can do to, you know, put the heat on this matter, to raise it up the agenda a bit more? It seems to me that we only hear about it in situations like this, but, you know, we don't hear much about it at any other time.
Well, we've consistently raised it with the UK government every opportunity we can. Let me give you an example. We're in a situation where we are looking to have to replace the radio systems which are used by our emergency services, including police, fire and ambulance service. That over the course of the lifetime of that contract, which we're negotiating and working with the Home Office on, it will probably cost us in excess of £400 million over the course of taking that particular area of work forward. The reality is that we are the only part of the UK that will be sitting around that table having to pay VAT on this. Every other part of the UK that's joining in this particular programme won't be paying VAT on it. So we're taking every opportunity to highlight the inequity of the situation that we find ourselves in, that we have two of our key public services here in Scotland, emergency services, having to pay VAT in a way that no other service of a similar nature in other parts of the UK have to meet. And, for example, going forward in new investments, when it does come to working in a pan-UK basis, we are the only body sitting down at a negotiating table having to pick up the VAT costs which are attached to it as well.
That it was the Finance Committee of this Parliament which flagged up that there was a problem at the time when the legislation went through, so it was actually known. But at that stage, Northern Ireland had been exempted by the legislation at the time when the VAT legislation went through. Northern Ireland was specifically exempted. Now, obviously, the UK government has exempted a number of other organisations since then. Have they given any indication to you why they have taken a rather intransigent position on the Scottish Police and Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, where they've been prepared to change the rules for others?
To a large extent, no. And you're correct to say they have chosen to give other bodies exemption. There was the Olympic Legacy Committee, which was a national organisation, was given VAT exemption. It appears to be that, sadly, I think it's politically motivated, and I think it's entirely unacceptable. And we'll continue to make representations to the UK government on this matter at every opportunity. To date, we haven't had any further progress in this matter with the UK government, despite our repeated calls to them to address this matter. They've given, other than to say it's because it's a nationally funded body, it no longer qualifies for VAT exemption. Beyond that, there has been no further explanation.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. John.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Convener, can I first declare that an interest is the recipient of a police pension, because it is featured in there. Cabinet Secretary, I'm trying to understand the relationship between two of the statements made by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance on the 16th of December. One of them says, I'm pleased to confirm today that we will provide real terms of protection for the frontline policing resource budget next year, and if we are re-elected in May, for every year of the next Parliament, which is a boost of £100 million over that period. And the further statement, I'm announcing further support today instead of removing the reform budget as Parliament intended in order to consolidate the reforms and to support the work of the police. I'm committing a further £55 million next year to the important task of community safety. Can you talk about the relationship between these two statements, please? And in particular, in the event of your government being re-elected, is that an additional £20 million that's to be injected straight away in May?
So, do you mean May of 2016-17?
Yes.
That's in terms of real terms increase, it's £17 million.
The relationship between these two statements, and a boost of £100 million over the period in the event of you being re-elected, plus the announcement of a further £55 million next year to the important task of community safety.
So, in terms of projecting forward the real terms increase that would actually be in the resource budget over that period, it would accumulate to just over £100 million over that five-year period.
What would it mean for 16-17, Cabinet Secretary?
Pardon?
What would it mean for 16-17?
That's the £17 million that I referred to Gil Paterson in my earlier response.
So is that the £55 million then?
So that's the first note. In terms of, there's two separate things here. There is the police central government budget, which is a £55 million that you're referring to, which is the continuation of the reform budget that's going forward. And then there's a real terms increase in the resource budget of Police Scotland. And what that means is that the real terms increase in the resource budget for Police Scotland over the term of a five-year period, if it's a real term, if you give a real terms protection, would be just over £100 million. And in the 2016-17 budget, that will amount to just over £17 million. The £55 million of central government central government reform budget is separate to that. That is in addition to that.
What is the additional sum in the event of your party being re-elected in May? What's the additional sum? I'm trying to imagine that, and I'm not campaigning for you, obviously, but, can people look forward to a windfall of what? Five into £100 million, £20 million extra? So, is that what you're saying?
So it's £17 million additional in the 16-17, and over the course of the five-year period, actually, it starts to increase in further years, the way the profile for a real terms protection would actually operate, which would accumulate over that five-year period to around £100 million of additional resource.
So as regards the statement of £100 million, it doesn't really need that qualifying, but if we are re-elected, it's there anyway.
It would be, well, this is a one-year budget, which is £17 million. If we, as the Deputy First Minister set out, we are committed to maintaining that in future budgets. Another government, a change of government, could result in a change of budget approach.
So it is £17
million then? £17 million because it's a one-year budget. What we have given a commitment to is if we are re-elected, over the course of that five-year period, it will accumulate to over £100 million.
Okay, thanks. We're going to deal with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service separately, but it's my understanding that they'll be able to retain capital receipts in respect of property disposals. Is that the case for the police?
Yes.
Yes, it is.
And what will they be able to use that money for?
Well, it'd be for them to decide on what they want to use that to invest in capital projects or in other projects that they're taking forward. So,
new purposes?
Pardon?
Could they use it for revenue purposes?
No, it'd be capital.
It would be capital?
Yes.
And
so you're aware you can't put capital into revenue?
Right, I'm just checking on that. So with regard to a major capital project, that's the ICT project, and I6 in particular, is there a contingency to deal with that at all?
Contingency to deal with?
Any difficulties that may arise with that?
As in the way of an overspend? Or a change in the cost?
Contractual difficulties?
Well, there's they've got a contractual agreement in place just now for taking forward that project with the company who are responsible for developing I6. That would be a matter for both Police Scotland and ASPA to work out within their own budgets if there was any additional cost that may be associated with that. They haven't highlighted anything at this particular point, given the contract that they have in place at the present time. What they are able to do is, if they want to use some of their capital receipts to undertake other areas around ICT infrastructure, capital investment, then for some of the capital receipts they receive in the course of a year, they'd be able to do that if they thought that was necessary.
And that would include use for I6?
Well, if technically it was necessary, but I'm not aware of any indication that there have been that there is any need for additional costs associated with it at this stage.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Roderick, followed by Mark Mitchell.
Thank you, Convener. Happy New Year to you, Cabinet Secretary.
Happy New Year.
I'd like just to kind of build on a couple of the themes that Gil Patterson and John Finney have talked about in relation to the budget. Since we took evidence on the 1st of December, Audit Scotland have produced a report in that report, paragraph 20 of their report, they make reference to the fact that the Scottish Police Authority forecasted an overspend of £25.3 million against its 2015-16 revenue budget. They go on to commenting on the comment of the First Minister about a real terms increase in the police revenue budget, to suggest that if a 1% real terms budget increase is assumed for every year from 2016-17 to 2020-21, we estimate there could still be a cumulative funding gap of over £80 million by 2018-19, unless additional savings are made. It's my understanding that this report was prepared before the Deputy First Minister gave his budget statement. Would you like to just comment on that particular paragraph and ways in which it might not tell the full story?
You're correct to say that the Audit Scotland report was published prior to our draft budget being published. Now, there's a number of assumptions that they've made within their particular report, which obviously did not take account of some of the measures that we've published in the draft budget. So, for example, the Audit Scotland projected budget figure assumes that there would be no reform funding allocated to the SPA in any year. In fact, that's the reform budget I was referring to, the additional £55 million, which has been allocated as part of this draft budget. Additionally, the Audit Scotland net expenditure figure was based on a starting assumption of an overspend of £22.3 million at the end of the current financial year. In fact, we understand that the end-of-year overspend will be significantly lower than that as a result of the recovery plan which the SPA and Police Scotland have put in place. Additionally, the Audit Scotland budget gap figures are based in part on the assumption that there are no further efficiency savings that will be achieved in future years. In fact, some of the current year's savings have actually been delayed until next year. And also the reform budget, as I mentioned earlier on, is to assist Police Scotland in achieving some of the changes which they need in order to obtain further savings. So these Audit Scotland projections were compiled in advance of the Scottish Government's draft budget, which was published before the Christmas recess. And obviously we've also, in addition, given the commitment, as the First Minister's outlined, to, if re-elected, and maintaining a real terms increase for Police Scotland's budget in future years.
Thank you. If I could also perhaps move on now to a report from HMICS, which I also think came after we conducted our budget session on the 1st of December, but touches on also the question of the absence of a financial strategy on the part of the SPA. Again, if I just quote from Mr. Penman's report, while the current commitment to maintaining an additional 1,000 officers is welcomed and has strengthened policing across Scotland, it can only remain effective and efficient whilst these officers continue to perform operational policing roles. In the absence of a long-term vision of policing, a wider workforce strategy and a clear financial strategy, there is a real risk that financial savings will continue to focus primarily on reducing police staff. Would you like to comment on that paragraph? And also, in particular, the absence of a financial strategy on the part of the SBA?
Well, maybe to rewind to the start then, in police reform, there was obviously the outline business case, which was developed and published in 2011, which was a very detailed outline business case, arguably actually possibly one of the most detailed outline business cases for a major area of public sector reform. And that set out a range of different options in progressing reform within policing. The any further financial strategy or financial business case would then have to be taken forward within Police Scotland and within the SPA once it had been established. And if I recall correctly, you previously received evidence from the former Chief Constable, Stephen House, in stating out that that work could only then be taken forward once the organisations had been established. The early work which was undertaken by Police Scotland and SPA was around their corporate strategy, which set out a range of different areas, including their financial aspect, their personnel, and a whole range of other areas that they would be taking forward over the three-year period. Now, what they are doing is, and having taken that that forward over the last couple of years, is that they're now obviously in a position where, having published their draft budget, has been able to set out their financial strategy for the forthcoming financial year and how that will then plan into the future. We've also, as a government, given an indication what our intentions would be over the next 5 years, which will give them greater certainty and be able to plan around their financial strategy in moving forward. And the other important bit of work which they are presently undertaking, which will report by the summer of next year, is the work that they are looking around at future demands on the service and to plan for the future. So a combination of having set out a draft budget allows them to plan for the forthcoming financial year and also potentially for the next 5 years. And the piece of work which the SPA are undertaking around future demands being placed on the service and the nature of the demands which will be made of the service in coming years will assist them as well in being able to look at what they need in the way of resources, not just in financial resources and personnel resources, and the way in which they deploy them as well to meet that demand.
Thank you. That perhaps with the review on police governance which you set up in September, all these factors coming together might mean that there is a need to kind of review exactly where the police budget is going, not necessarily for next year, but for the years of the next Parliament. You take that on board in terms of the kind of a wider...
Well, the police governance review, which I asked the new chair to undertake, will be completed by the spring of next year, alongside the work which they'll complete in the summer of next year around future demands that the service will be facing as well. Looking forward over the next 5 to 10 years period will allow them to give a clearer indication as to what they believe may be the financial demands and the wider demands which will be placed on the services, and we'll have to wait to see what the outcome of those particular pieces of work are. But we've sought to provide as much assurance as we can from this budget and for future budgets from our perspective, around what the police budget would look like in future years, which gives them a greater level of certainty in planning for these matters.
Thank you.
Margaret Mitchell, followed by Margaret McDougall, and followed by Alison.
Just to continue that line of questioning, Cabinet Secretary, on the 18th of December, Audit Scotland were very critical of the SPA's accounts. They did forecast this deficit, which you've talked about in part, you know, from a recovery plan and other measures. But they did express some concern about incomplete records, poor financial management. Are you now satisfied that that has been resolved in SPA?
So there's, in addition to the points I was making earlier on to Rod Campbell about the differences between what's now in the draft budget from the assumptions that were used by Audit Scotland, the issue around their accountancy work is an area where the Scottish Police Authority have assured me that they are taking action in order to make sure they've got greater accuracy around these areas. You may be aware that one of their intentions is to appoint an interim Chief Financial Officer in order to support some of that work over the coming months in order to address some of the deficiencies which have been highlighted to ensure there is a greater accuracy around these matters. So the SPA are very committed to making sure that these issues are addressed and are taking action just now in order to do so.
The other criticism was the long-term financial strategy. That was first called for in 2013. I think you've stated it was unrealistic to have a long-term strategy then when so much had been decided. We're now in 2016, and although you've mentioned a recovery plan and a review coming next year, how confident can we be that either Police Scotland or the SPA have a long-term financial strategy, i.e. 3 to 4 years in place?
Well, that's one of the reasons why we've set out over the next 5 years what we intend to see as the resource budget for Police Scotland, is to support them and assist them in being able to undertake that work. So given that we have provided them with a greater level of detail over the coming years, that will support them and assist them to be able to do that. And they're undertaking already a detailed level of work off the back of the draft budget, which was late, not through our choice, but late as a result of the delay at Westminster, to now plan for the forthcoming financial year, and by setting out our intentions, what our intentions would be if re-elected for the next 5 years, provides them with a greater level of understanding around what their finances would look like over that period of time.
But it's fair to say that that long-term financial strategy is not in place for either Police Scotland or SPA.
Well, they're undertaking that work just now on the basis of the draft budget. They had a three-year strategy, which they'd taken forward as part of their corporate strategy. And they're now, as a result of the draft budget, able to now take forward their planning for the forthcoming financial year.
I think Audit Scotland's point that they first asked for it in 2013, we're now in 2016, we're still no closer to it, is maybe something to reflect on.
However, can I just say, I think we'd be confusing a couple of different things here. There was outlined business case. Are you referring to the financial strategy on its own or the full business case?
A long-term strategy, financial strategy, called for by Audit Scotland in 2013. Now, I understand why you said that was unrealistic.
Yes.
We're now 3 years on from that, and we still don't have it.
That's fine. Just in case we were confusing two different things there.
So that's fine. If I could look at some of the things that were listed as priorities for the justice portfolio, the work with national and local partners through Building Our Safer Communities programme to reduce number of victims of crime and unintentional injury, our focus on prevention and early intervention will be targeted, addressing underlying causes of crime and changing offending behaviour. Now, obviously, one of these partners will be Police Scotland. However, I notice that the budget for a safer, stronger communities has been reduced dramatically, both in real and cash terms. Could you perhaps comment how that fits in with the priority?
You're referring to Table 8.10, the safer and stronger communities.
And I think they give
the level three funding. Yeah,
yeah.
Breakdown. That's because the drugs misuse element of that budget has been transferred to health. So I've taken the view that the issue of drug treatment is primarily not a criminal justice issue; it's a public health issue. And if we wish to tackle this issue much more effectively in a coordinated fashion, then in my view, it would be better if those resources were actually within the health portfolio in order to undertake that work, given that most of that work is undertaken by health agencies in the first place. So that reduction which you're seeing there, that marked reduction, is a result of the transferring out of resource from the justice portfolio into the health portfolio for drug treatment. And that will allow for a more coordinated approach to drug and alcohol treatment to be taken forward.
That seems to assume that the vast majority, just about all of the problems associated with safer communities, are drug-related, whereas we know there's many reasons why communities sometimes feel under threat. Antisocial behaviour at lower end, serious organised crime and threats to communities through serious organised crime type activity. So are you confident that there is sufficient there, given that huge reduction in the budget, to keep our communities safer from the wider threats which are undoubtedly out there?
Well, it's a reduction in our budget line because the money has transferred out of justice into health.
But that's just for drugs.
It's for drug treatment.
It's for drug treatment, yes.
Yeah, so the work around, for example, that Police Scotland and other organisations take forward around enforcement, around education, etc., all of that work continues. Will be supported. This was money which was specifically for drug treatment, and I'm of the view that's a public health issue, which is better placed within the health and wellbeing portfolio than being within the justice portfolio, and that's why that resource is transferred across.
Yeah, police prevention works mainstream within the budget.
Yeah. So
building safer communities is really just, by any other name, a drug prevention and tackling the causes of drugs treatment, which is better in health.
No. This was money which was specifically ring-fenced that the Justice Portfolio gave to health boards for the purposes of the treatment of those who...
If you went down to level four on this year's budget, mm-hmm. £33.2 million would be spent on drug treatment. And that's just come out of this budget.
It's been transferred across to health because I'm of the view that drug treatment is an issue which is a public health matter, and it's better placed there and to be managed there within health policy. The issue around tackling a serious and organised crime that's associated with drugs, the issue about drug prevention work that takes place within communities as well, all of that is mainstream stuff that's undertaken by Police Scotland. So that will all continue as part of their normal day-to-day work. This was money which was very specific for drug treatment.
So there's nothing else then that you would be concerned about under the Safer and Stronger Communities budget or anything that might fall under that, any activity that might fall under that, that is not sufficiently resourced? You're quite confident about that?
Well, I'm confident the right thing to do is that, given the way in which drug treatment is delivered at a local level, largely by our health service and their partners, that this is something which is better suited as being dealt with as a public health issue.
I think maybe the member's point is, though, that the 7.1, there hasn't been any reduction to anything else that's done under that budget heading. In terms of the 7.1, there's not any transfer from any other project.
No, this is purely for drug treatment.
I certainly understand the point you're making then, but there will be other things. Obviously, there's £7.1 million worth of other things being done under that budget headline, and there hasn't been any reduction to those.
So
other parts?
There's one of the things where there is a reduction is in the work around sectarianism. That was a four-year programme that was put in place, which has come to an end. That's the end of that four-year programme. So the level of resource which has been allocated to that has been reduced. There is still money which is provided for that area of work, but the programme of work was planned over a four-year period and it's come to the end of its four-year allocation period. So that reduces. But beyond that, the marked reduction is a result of a transfer out of resources and a change of approach, which I think as of the next financial year, we'll see health and wellbeing leading on the drug treatment area, which, as I see, is a public health issue.
And very finally, the UK government have pledged to maintain the policing budget in real terms. The Cabinet Secretary has talked about protecting or maintaining the budget for frontline policing. Is it the same thing?
No, it's in real terms.
In real terms, yes. Yeah. So frontline policing is the whole budget then?
It's a revenue budget. It's a real terms revenue budget.
Is it the same thing, though? Frontline policing seems to suggest very focused police on the beat. What about support staff?
It's a resource budget which we allocate to the SPA for the purposes of delivering Police Scotland, which has had real terms protection.
So it's all encompassing?
For the resource budget of the SPA, which goes to Police Scotland, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Margaret McDougall has indicated that her question has been asked, so Alison is there.
Thank you. You mentioned the outline business case that sort of supposedly underpinned all of the reform, and I have to disagree that business case was credible. I mean, I think it made a number of unsubstantiated claims and over-optimistic savings targets, and I would ask you to agree that that's... held out, that view is held out, because the Reform Fund was supposed to end at the end of this year, wasn't it?
It was initially in the financial memorandum, it went alongside the legislation, it was for a three-year period.
Yeah. So the £55 million that you've had to find for the forthcoming year for reform is a recognition that your government has miscalculated the level of savings that the reforms could achieve in that timescale, is that correct?
No.
So why then have you allocated that extra funding?
To what we've agreed is that we believe they've gone through the major consolidation part of reform of Police Scotland, and in order to support the next phase of that is that the Deputy First Minister has agreed that we should provide them with further budget in order to allow them further funding in order to allow them to continue some areas of reform. There's already been very significant levels of savings being achieved by Police Scotland. So, for example, have achieved a cumulative over to which would take them up to the 2025-26 almost £880 million of savings, which have been addressed, and they're already making further progress in achieving the £1.1 billion, which was the intended figure that they should achieve as a result of the savings that they would manage.
Some of those earlier savings, I would argue, have been rushed and ill thought through. And I mean, we only need to think about control rooms and how we've had to put a bit of a break on some of those reforms. Is that reflected in this £55 million?
In what sense?
In the view that you need to slow down the reform round about control centres.
No, we provided some additional resource in year to assist Police Scotland in some of the challenges that we're facing around the call centre changes. The reform budget is not specific for, it's for that call centre or for that particular aspect of the service. It's allowed them to identify as they're progressing and moving forward, areas where they want to achieve investment, which can allow them to operate more efficiently and more effectively, and where they can achieve savings from that, to give them some support and assisting them in achieving that.
How will you release that extra money? Because the Audit Scotland report that others have referred to said that there needed to be greater transparency in how the bodies, SPA and Police Scotland, have until now used the reform funding. What kind of assurance work have you done to review how that earlier funding was used?
So one of the pieces of work which the SPA are undertaking is to make sure that the way in which any reform money is used, that it is actually delivering reform. proper reform of the service. And what will happen is that for Police Scotland, if they identify an area where they wish to undertake further reform and they need some additional resource in year in order to support that, is from them to then go to the SPA to set that out, for the SPA to be very thorough in their detail in considering these matters. And at that point, they will then be in a position where they can then come to the Scottish Government to request access to some of that reform budget to support them in undertaking that work. But I recognise that I think the underlying point the member is making around whether the reform budget is always delivering the level of reform that we'd like to see it delivering. I think there's an opportunity for us to make sure that we are utilising it as effectively as possible to deliver reform in a way that is improving the service overall. So there's a process in place for them accessing that money, that resource, and it will be there to help to support transformation and reform of the service.
Okay, you've said it's not for any specific projects and it's for the SPA to come forward with bids into it, but you must have been able to quantify that money in some regard. So what have you taken into account in coming to the figure of 55 million?
Well, I've looked at some of the areas where the police need to make some further investment, particularly capital investment, in order to improve the way in which the service is operating. There's no doubt that ICT is one of those areas where further investment would support them in helping to reduce bureaucracy and helping to also promote greater efficiency and to free up officers' time as well. And that's an area where we want to continue to provide them with support. We've also, as you'll be aware, from the call centre review that was undertaken by HMICS, highlighted some issues around the ICT systems, etc. as well. Again, in helping to improve and looking how they want to improve that, if they saw there was an issue around some capital investment into ICT provision in that area, again, that's something which would reform and improve the way in which the service is operating. It'd be an opportunity for them to then look at identifying areas there. So I think there's one of the big areas where I think there can be further improvement is particularly around ICT. The other aspect is that there can be in-year demands that come up that were not anticipated, but it may come along as an opportunity where further investment at an early stage could realise get better improvements as well, and it allows us to have some flexibility and be able to meet some of those in-year demands that may occur as a result of a change in practice or a particular issues being flagged up.
And can I have your assurance, Cabinet Secretary, that community safety and the safety of the citizens of Scotland will be at the heart of any of these future efficiencies, and that you won't be driven too fast and too quick?
Oh, that's absolutely crucial. That's central to it. And I don't think there should be any doubt either this government, the SPA or Police Scotland are all signed up to making sure that our primary objective is the safety and the security of citizens in Scotland, and to do that. And I think there are clearly lessons that can be learned from some of the way in which changes have been taken forward in the past. For example, in the call centres, the recommendation that we should be that a gateway review should have been undertaken prior to that being progressed. I think it's a very clear, concrete example of where lessons can be learned when you are changing aspects of the service, and what we need to do is to make sure that those types of lessons are being properly learned and implemented in the future. So I can give you an absolute assurance that is what we're very committed to, and what I'm personally very committed to, ensuring that Police Scotland and the SPA are completely focused on, alongside making sure that where we can learn from issues in the past, that we do so.
Thanks, Convener.
Thanks. I'll take one final question from Roddy Campbell, and we'll move on to the fire service.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener. It's just a couple of points. Just on the reform budget, when Deputy Chief Constable Richardson gave evidence, he talked about the initial phase of reform being the trying to maintain core services and to consolidate. That was the phase that brought various organisations into a single operating entity. But the next stage of the journey is around what might be better understood as the really transformative activity, which involves changing processes and doing things differently, being slicker and sharper. Would you agree with that comment? Is that something that we would look forward to seeing kind of significant savings on over the next 5 years?
Well, I think there's absolutely no doubt over almost 3 years now there has been a very significant level of consolidating different approaches and eight different legacy forces. You know, at one point, with eight different legacy forces, there were 18 different computer systems used for different aspects of the service, some of which didn't actually communicate with one another because different legacy forces had taken a different approach to different issues. You know, there have obviously been significant challenges in drawing some of these issues together. And I think there has been a very significant level of transformation has taken place already over this initial three-year period. And Deputy Chief Constable Richardson's correct in that there is an opportunity, I believe, in going forward over the next couple of years to see further transformation that it delivers better improvements for the public and how it responds to public demand and public need, and equally also improves greater efficiency within the services. You know, just to give you an example, there are various aspects of our public services that are that procure a whole range of different issues, and I have no doubt that greater collaboration between the public sector, which is already happening, but taken further, can help to support greater efficiency in procurement and in and also in cooperating with one another on how they go about some of the changes that they're taking forward.
Thank you. And just a quick point, are you happy with the budget for PERC and HMICS, given the kind of considerable role that both of these organisations take at present time?
Well, for PERC, which is also part of, which is one of the elements within the Police Central government budget as well, there's actually an increase in their budget line, which will support them in terms of some accommodation and staffing levels as well. So we'll provide them with the a financial increase this year. And also the HMICS is are broadly able to operate within the resource that they have at the present moment. There's been no indication of any need for any increase in resources, but we have provided additional allocation to PERC to support them because of the changing nature of the demand that they've faced over recent times.
Thank you.
Can I invite members' questions on the budget for the Fire and Rescue Service, please? Christine? Margaret? Christine?
Yeah. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and a Happy New Year to you. And I think maybe we didn't say that at the outset, but this year has been quite challenging for our emergency services. Some of us in the committee will have spent some time with firefighters, particularly firefighters, in the floodings and with the police as well, very much present. I spent a lot of time with both firefighters and fire service. And regarding the budget, you would think that police officers would be delighted with the latest response from the Scottish Government, with some reassurances not only for this budget, but for 5 years ahead. I don't think we've got the same level of reassurances for the fire services. And as much as the Scottish Fire Rescue Services said that they suggested that a flat cash budget settlement for 16-17 could be managed by the fire service, a cash reduction would be extremely challenging and will maybe have a problem with keeping them aside with the years to come. Are you confident that this level of funding will be adequate for 16-17, and have you got anything in line for the years afterwards, the same thing that you did for the police?
Well, dealing with your latter point, first, we will obviously deal with the fire service budget in the next phase of the next phase of the budget round. But in relation to this particular financial year 16-17, I do believe it's a budget which is manageable in continuing to make progress around the reform of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. And as you heard from the Chief Fire Officer, Alistair Hay, when he gave evidence to you, that a flat cash settlement would be manageable. That's what we have delivered for them in this financial year. But having said that, I fully recognise that public sector organisations will find it challenging in general, just given the overall squeeze that there are on public sector budgets. Which is why we need to be very vigilant in making sure that we are achieving as much efficiency as we can
and how we progress reform in these organisations, and the Fire and Rescue Service will be no different to any other aspect of the public sector in having to make sure that we are operating as efficiently and as effectively as possible while delivering the best standard of service that we can to the people of Scotland. And I think it'd be fair to say the way in which the Fire and Rescue Service have operated over the last week or so, given the significant demands both in the borders and in the North East, has been exemplary. And they've discharged that responsibility, I think, to a tremendously high standard, and have been able to operate in a way which has allowed them to flex resource in a way which would have been more challenging with the previous setup. But as a national force, they've been able to move resource in a way which has allowed them greater flexibility to meet that demand in particular areas.
Thank you for that, Commissioner. In your draft budget, you talked about exploring opportunities for the fire service to make a wider contribution to public services. And we heard from the Fire Brigade Union that discussion were in place to widen the role of firefighters, particularly regarding medical emergencies. We know that in other countries it's the case. Can you expand on what you have in mind as part of the wider contribution, and particularly we need additional funding to be part of those discussions?
Well, I think there's, for example, the nature and the role of the fire service has been changing over a number of years now in the areas of work that they're engaged in. So, for example, if you look historically in the way in which they've increasingly been involved in road traffic accidents and inland water rescues, as well, the way in which that role has expanded over a number of years now is an example of the way in which the service has evolved to meet some of the demands which were being placed upon that. One of the areas where we are keen to see a greater collaboration in working with is around work with the Scottish Ambulance Service. Some of this is not about additional financial resource as such, but it's about using the resource that we have at the present time in a slightly different way and being able to respond to things. So, for example, when I was the Minister for Public Health, I was very keen in pursuing the whole issue of out-of-hospital cardiac arrests. We know the statistics greatly improve in terms of survival rates if we can get someone there who's properly trained with a defibrillator as early as possible. And if you look at places like Seattle in America, which is a gold standard internationally, that by using much quicker ways of responding to these incidents and getting someone there with a defibrillator much more quickly can help to improve the survival rate for that particular patient. So we've got a couple of pilots which we're running just now with the Fire and Rescue Service off the back of the strategy which I initiated as Minister for Public Health around out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, where we are working with the local fire service in three areas in order to look at how they can assist the Scottish Ambulance Service in responding to out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. Now, that's not about taking firefighters away from the duties which they're normally doing. This will be is that if there is a fire appliance available which has a defibrillator on it, which is going to be able to reach that individual more quickly than the ambulance will be able to get there, is being able to deploy that resource. So it's a resource which would otherwise may not be getting used at that particular point. So it's about trying to help to close down some of these gaps and to maximise the use of the resources which are there. And that type of collaboration has a benefit to the public, and also it makes much better use of our public sector resources in meeting the demands and some of these needs.
Well, I do understand all this, but there is a question. You said early on that you took some of the resources and you moved them to the National Health Service for very good reason. And, you know, there will be a reason, you know, the Scottish Fire Service could see that there will be a reason that if the scopes is enlarged about what the firefighters could be, that some of the resources could come from the National Health Service and could move to the Scottish Fire Rescue Services. I don't think in that discussion there should be a discussion about extra level of funding coming maybe not from your own cabinet secretary, but maybe come from another cabinet secretary. That needs to be explored.
That sounded like a pitch for some money coming into Justice from Health. So, we've got these three pilots, and I think we need to see how they progress and how, and to evaluate them and to see what progress has been made with them, to then understand whether there are any mapped resource implications that could come about as a result of them, and we could explore that then. But I do think it's a good example of, you know, the reality is that this is money which is all coming from the same pot and allocated into different portfolios. I think it's if it delivers better outcomes for the public, then I think we've all got a collective responsibility to make sure that we are working across government to utilise that resource to the best effect that we can to deliver the best possible services. And once we've evaluated these three pilots, I can't remember exactly where they are. As ever, there's always one in the Borders. Aberdeenshire and Dundee area, yeah. Is it? I think it's in the Dundee area, the three areas we're trialling this out. And we can evaluate that and see where that goes from.
The office is very good, but you know, this additional funding could have an impact on the number of firefighters, particularly in one of the rural communities which have been affected by flooding. So that will be a reassurance that if we could put that in future budget, will be very, very important. Not only this, you know, we're talking about VAT early on. We have been told that if we had the VAT back, it could add 350 firefighters. You know, if we don't get that money back to keep that level of firefighters that we need for the emergency services, I would ask you to consider it for the budget coming.
No, I appreciate the comment you're making and the point you're making. What I'm very mindful of is that even with these pilots, is that what we can't see is in the Fire and Rescue Service undertaking additional areas of responsibility that result in having a negative impact in their core responsibility. What we're trying to do is to look at in making sure that they continue to deliver their core responsibilities. Is there scope in there to utilise highly trained firefighters and the resources which are deployed across our communities more effectively to help to support greater community safety and greater community cohesion? And if we can look at how we can use that resource more effectively to help deliver that, then let's explore that. Then the hospital cardiac arrest pilots are a practical examples of us moving into that area, which could have a very significant impact in helping to improve saving lives and also in promoting community safety. And it's worth keeping in mind, you know, that the level of community safety work that the fire service now undertake is very, very significant, whether it be visiting properties to install smoke detectors, etc. Is a big part of their prevention work, and a very detailed part of the prevention work that has allowed us to see the reductions that we have in fire fatalities as a result of that. So, you know, the fire service no longer just work on the basis that they are about just going to fight fires. It's also about prevention and reducing that risk. And some of the work around, if they're going into a house to do a fire assessment, it's an elderly person with a smoke detector, look, they can also undertake some work there in looking at trip risks. Which again, an elderly person at home having falling, injuring themselves, potentially fracturing their hip, something like that. You know, I saw that previously in my professional career. Somebody's managing fine at home, fractured hip, into hospital, have to have a hip replacement. Their mobility may never recover. They can end up getting complications while in the hospital. And you can sadly see a downward spiral in that person's independence as a result. While they're in the house, is there other things that they could identify? And if so, then refer it on to another agency who could pick up some of these issues. So but trying to maximise the use of that resource and their skills as best we can to try and help to support some of these community safety measures.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Okay. Thank you. Happy New Year to you, Cabinet Secretaries. In relation to the rationalisation of control rooms, a submission from the Fire Brigade Union argued for resources to ensure a successful delivery of what it described as a high-risk project, the concerns being around less staff, covering a wider geographic area, and obviously the loss of local knowledge in there. So what is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that problems do not arise?
Well, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service have undertaken a very significant level of work and planning around moving to the three control room model, which is in Edinburgh, Johnston and in Dundee. That programme will be completed and delivered by 2015. Part of that work's already been taken forward with the Johnston control room, with the control room in Dumfries already having transferred in November of last year. They've already opened and upgraded and enhanced the control room in Edinburgh, which was completed just back in November of last year. The Madison control room will be merging with the control room in Edinburgh in a phased basis during January of this year, and it'll be completed by the end of January this month, and then that will then follow with the merger of the Thornton control room over the next couple of months. Now, they've taken forward a range of different measures in order to, for example, having the systems running in shadow to one another, in order to make sure that they've got resilience and that the new approach is working effectively and efficiently. So they've taken forward a range of different measures in order to try and help to reduce the risk of any potential problems with their control rooms. Progress today has indicated that that's been managed. So it's been an area of work which has been planned for a considerable period of time and has been implemented over a period of time in order to ensure that the public continue to receive the quality of service that they expect.
Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the concerns that the union raised was around training and evaluation, and you know that may be compromised as part of this rationalisation. Can you assure me today that that is has been addressed?
Well, my understanding is that all staff in the control rooms are trained for the purposes of managing the system, and that's part of the ongoing work which the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service have been taking forward. I've had no direct indications, given it already part of this is transferred, that there have been any issues around the training of staff. Part of the ongoing work as the transfer takes place is the continued training of staff in operating the system.
Mm-hmm. So you think the resources are adequate to carry out that training, given the...
Well, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service have already been taking this forward. It's not something which they're about to start. It's already part of the work which they're already undertaking with some of the control rooms. As I mentioned already, the Dumfries control room having transferred to Johnston having taken place, and the Madison and Edinburgh work are already moving forward at the present moment. So it's an area where they've already demonstrated that transfer can be managed effectively and efficiently, and staff are being properly trained in order to make sure the system. It is worth keeping in mind is that the volume of calls which the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service deals with compared to that of the Scottish Police Service is significantly different as well, and the other difference between the call centres that we have in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service is only 999 calls that they're dealing with. They don't have an equivalent 101 in the way in which Police Scotland have, where they've got 101 and 999 calls. So the volume and some of the complications around them are significantly different, but they've already been managing the service and the transfer over effectively, and there's no indication as to any anticipated further problems as they move forward.
Okay, thank you. Just before we move on to the court service, the Scottish Government assists the SPA with its VAT liability but doesn't assist the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. Can you explain why that is?
The Scottish Fire and Rescue Service VAT issues met within their resource budget, and that was a matter which was agreed with them previously, that they would meet that additional VAT cost from within their ongoing resource budget, and it's the same provision that we've made within this financial settlement.
Roderick, you wanted to?
Yeah, no, just a quick point. The number of fires last year that were attended to by the Fire and Rescue Service was down 11%. Do we have now the right number of firefighters? Because the number of firefighters has also been reduced over the last few years. Any comments on that generally, and whether the budget provides for enough firefighters?
Well, the configuration, the resource configuration is a process that's taken forward for firefighters. Is a process which is taken forward between the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and the Fire Brigades Union. I know there are some issues, for example, in the northeast where there have been some issues. It's not so much that the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service don't have enough firefighters, is that they just don't have enough of them in some of different parts of the country. So it's about, it's overall globally they've got the right numbers, but not necessarily all in the right places. So they've had an interim arrangement in place to with Fire Brigade Union to allow them to be able to move some firefighters to areas in order to help to meet where they have, where there have been potentially some gaps in numbers, and they're working with the FBU on a resource allocation model, which will help to make sure that they've got sustainable numbers across the country. So what we need to do is make sure that we've got the right firefighters in the right place in order to meet the demand which they face. There is obviously, of course, a very large part of the country which is covered by retained firefighters, and clearly there's work being undertaken just now by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service in order to revisit the approach the way in which they are utilising and the way in which they are providing retained cover, in order to make sure that it's able to meet the demands going forward in future years. So that's a very significant piece of work which has been undertaken. I know that the Chief Fire Officer said on a number of occasions he wants to make sure that it's more suited to the types of demands which have been placed on the service in rural communities today.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, so can I have volunteers for questions on the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service? Can I also indicate that we're in 5 minutes, we'll be actually overrunning this particular session, so concise questions and answers if at all possible. Thanks. John.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, we have growing confidence in the criminal justice system, both the police service and the prosecution service, which has seen a great number of historic sexual abuse inquiries come to light. There's an increased number of solemn cases. There's a prioritisation of domestic cases. There's an increased role for the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service in relation to victims. We've heard from the Inspector of Prosecution about the challenges faced. The FDA union talk about the pressures faced by prosecution staff, stating we do not consider it to be reasonable or achievable to continue to expect the service to deliver more with less. We'll shortly take evidence from you on more legislation which will create more work. Now, I'm aware of alternatives to prosecution, and I'm aware of the fiscal fines and direct measures that are in place, but is it really sustainable, the level of budget and the increased workload that's coming the way?
Well, you're right to say that there is growing confidence amongst certain groups of victims of crime to report certain matters, and it's also a reflection, I think, on the very significant change in approach that our police service now take to some of these issues. So, for example, in domestic violence matters, if it's reported by one individual, they will then look for previous partners in order to see whether there was domestic violence in the past. And it can result in a number of victims then having cases brought before the court, which has clearly created pressures on the court system, because very often, by the very nature of these types of offences, early pleas are not often entered, which results in them going to trial. We've recognised that. In the year 2014-15, we provided additional resource of 1.47 million pounds, which was to help to support both the courts, prosecution services, in order to meet some of that, and the judiciary to meet some of the additional demands that they were facing in year, and in this financial year in 15-16, we have provided an additional £2.4 million in order to support again further work for both the prosecution services and our courts to meet that additional demand. So
Over the last 2 years alone, we have provided almost £4 million of additional resource to help to meet some of these in-year demands which they can experience on the court service. Clearly, you know, our prosecution services are like any other part of our public services in that they have to operate within the financial budget which is set for them. I'm confident they'll be able to manage that as effectively as they can. Clearly, in terms of how that then is taken forward within the service is a matter for the Lord Advocate and how he then takes these issues forward that's independent of government. But I'm confident that they'll manage within the budget which has been set for them and to try it. And what we will do is we will obviously continue to monitor these things through the Justice Board to look at any changes in demand which have been experienced in year, how we can get agencies working much more effectively together to help to offset some of the challenges which they're facing. So we've got greater cooperation taking place. And we'll continue to do that going forward.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Margaret Mitchell, followed by Alison, followed by Margaret McDougall.
The fact remains, Cabinet Secretary, that there has been a budgetary provision, a budgetary fall in the provision in real terms, both in the case-related work, both in real and cash terms, and the overall budget for the Crown and Procurator Fiscal. Now, if the Scottish Government is legislating on issues like domestic abuse and human trafficking, which we all welcome, isn't it just only fair and reasonable, and in fact vital, that those at the sharp end of delivering the consequences of these of this legislation are adequately resourced to carry out this work and make sure the policy is a success?
Well, as you'll be aware, with any piece of legislation, we publish a financial memorandum which sets out the what are the anticipated financial implications of that legislation. So, for example, we've set that out for the bill which we're going to be discussing later on this morning as to what the financial implications will be, the likely levels of prosecution. That there will be or cases that could end up in the courts that there could be in the course of a year, and we look at providing resource in order to try and meet those needs when we bring forward legislation. So I think it'd be wrong to give the impression that when we bring forward any legislation which makes additional provisions within our criminal justice system that we don't provide additional resource to meet some of those demands.
I don't think anyone's disputing that, but it's the greater volume of complex and serious cases that have materialised, which I think they're saying quite reasonably. I think Kathleen Dreyer saying we are coping just maybe, and the FDA saying that it's unreasonable to expect to do so much more, to deal with these more complex cases with less.
Which is why over the last 2 years we've provided additional resource to help to support both the Crown Procurator Fiscal Service and the courts to meet some of these increasingly complex cases. Because I know, for example, around the historical abuse issues, is that these can be very complex, detailed matters that can take a significant level of investigation by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and that's why we've provided in year additional resource to help to meet some of the additional demands which they're facing, and also to provide some additional resource to the courts in order to deal with this additional demand which they face as a result of these cases being brought before them.
So despite the kind of reports we've had about staff morale, etc., in the Crown and Procurator Fiscal, people under intolerable strain, it would be your contention that you think the Crown and Procurator Fiscal is adequately, services adequately resourced?
Well, I'm confident they'll be able to operate within the budget, which the Lord Advocate's agreed, and that they will take that forward on how they best believe that can be achieved within their particular service. You know, I'm always very keen to make sure that we have all of the different parts of our justice system operating collectively together as best we can. So I'm always conscious that if you do one part in the system, that will have an impact, and in our part of the system, that we try to make sure there's greater forward planning in these matters, which is what the Justice Board do, and in working to try and help to
to collaborate on these types of issues. So, you know, I've got no doubt that if you were to ask any part of the public sector, would you like more money, they would say yes. I don't suspect there are many cabinet secretaries who wouldn't want more money within their portfolio as well. But I'm confident that the budget which has been negotiated, as you're aware, the Lord Advocate negotiates this budget with the Deputy First Minister rather than myself, is it that they'll be able to manage within the budget that's been set for them, which is as you pointed out, is a flat cash settlement.
Yeah, but the point you make, I'm quite sure all public services would warmly welcome more money and even argue that they need it. But the point is that the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service has been at the cutting edge of government priorities in domestic abuse cases and in trafficking, which we welcome. And it was the extent to which cognizance has been taken of that and the impact it's had in the fiscal service. But I don't think we're going to get much further with that line. Could I ask you then, finally, obviously, for the prosecution service to work efficiently, there are other elements of the justice system which must be adequately resourced. However, there's a 7% cash terms reduction in legal aid, which will undoubtedly impact on the work of defence lawyers funded through the legal aid system. How will this be managed without it having a negative impact on the justice system?
Well, one of the things that we've sought not to do is to take the approach which has been taken forward in other parts, in England and Wales, for example, in restricting access to legal aid through reducing provision, for example, in civil matters. And we want to maintain as open access to the legal aid provision in Scotland as we can. So we are working to make sure that we continue to make sure that those who are eligible for legal aid, that they get access to it. What we need to do is to make sure it's operating as efficiently and effectively as possible. And we're already undertaking work in order to look at how we can model the way in which some parts of our court system is operating to make sure that it's operating as efficiently and effectively as possible, because some of the delays and some of the challenges around the way in which they're operating have actually significant costs which are then incurred as a result through some aspects of legal aid. So what we will be doing is in working with the legal profession, with others within the Justice Board, is to make sure that the legal aid system is operating as efficiently and effectively as possible, and that we are looking at how we can adjust and adapt some aspects of our justice system to make sure that they're operating as efficiently as effectively as possible, given the consequences that delays can actually have in cost to areas such as legal aid provision.
Do you have a for example?
It's an area of work we're taking forward at the present moment, and no doubt when we've get more detail around that, we will look at providing the committee with that information. But it's an area of work which we're actively looking at the present time.
I think the committee would warmly welcome, you know, the further detail.
Thank you. And just to return to the additional resources that you've given over the last 2 years, you said, I think, 1.7 million in
14-15
and 1.47,
yes.
Sorry, and rising over the 2 years to 4 million. So increasing resources required in year, but delivered on a sort of ad hoc basis. Would you agree that if resources are again required this forthcoming year on that scale, that it was perhaps important to review the base budget? Because I mean, what you can only do when you provide in year resources is only put a temporary sticking plaster on it. So you've not got the ability to perhaps bring in specialist professionals who can work over the period on that.
Well, it's worth keeping in mind, although we're discussing the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal's budget, that additional resource wasn't purely for the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, it was for different parts of it. So some of it went to the Scottish Court Service to support them as well, into undertaking some of the work and the additional capacity that they required. So it was to reflect some of that. That came about as a result of the partnership that we've got through the Justice Board in flagging up that they were experiencing some pressures as a result of another aspect of the system taking a different approach, and it was to offer some flexibility, and we'll continue to remain live to that. And obviously,
come the budget process for the 2017-18 period, then any further changes can be reflected on at that particular point. But we'll continue to remain alive to where we need to think, where we feel there is a need to have some level of flexibility to support where we can reasonably do that.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Justice Board approach is an interesting one and a useful way to join things up. Has it got access to a change fund, for example?
There are they don't have a budget as in that they allocate themselves as such. We have obviously the Reduce Reoffending Change Fund, which has been used over several years now in order to amend or to improve how we deal with some of the issues around reoffending, but they don't have a specific budget that they would be responsible for allocating directly. It's more about bringing a collaboration together to look at where there are different aspects of the system that can work much more effectively. So you've got from, you know, the reporter to the children's hearing system in Scotland, right through to the chief constable and senior officers, through to senior figures within the judiciary, to senior figures from within the Crown Office, and senior figures from the Justice Directorate, all there, all working collaboratively in order to try and make sure that we are joining up as much as we can, because it has been a tendency in the past in justice for different bits of the system to be operating in a way without recognising the impact it would have in other parts of the system, and the Justice Board's responsibilities to help to bring that together more effectively.
Okay, that's helpful.
Thanks. Margaret McDougall indicated her question has been asked, but Robert.
Thank you, Convener. Perhaps I can just refer to my register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates. Just a quick point on legal aid. Legal aid budget is under pressure. Are the concerns of people who think that that might lead to a reduction in the grants of criminal legal aid justified? What's your response to that?
For individual cases?
Yeah.
The purpose is to maintain access to legal aid in the way in which it is at the present moment, and across the legal aid provisions which we have. What we want to achieve is to achieve greater efficiency in the way in which it's operating.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I propose, since we have a longish session next, that we take a 5-minute break to stretch our legs. So I'll suspend for 5 minutes, please. very much. We'll now resume with item 5, the Abusive Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. This is the final evidence session, and the Cabinet Secretary is staying with us for this item, and I welcome the Scottish Government officials, Philip Lamont, Criminal Justice Division, Patrick Down from the Criminal Justice Division, Ian Fleming from Safer Communities Division, and Catherine Scott from the Directorate from Legal Services. We had an indication that the Cabinet Secretary doesn't wish to make an opening statement, but just ask him to confirm that. That's great. What I was going to propose on this, because there's obviously 6 different sections within the bill, the most conflicting evidence I think that we've had have been on judicial directions and the what was called revenge porn, but we're not actually supposed to call it that, the new offence of disclosing or threatening to disclose an intimate photograph or film. So I was going to propose taking questions on those sections first, and then going on to the other 6 areas that the bill covers. So if I could ask members for questions on the judicial directions first, Margaret and John Finney and Gail Patterson.
Yeah, as conveners indicated, then witnesses have expressed concern about the introduction of statutory jury directions in sexual offences cases, particularly with regard to undermining the independence of the judiciary. Does the Cabinet Secretary share these concerns?
No, I don't. I don't share the concerns. I will understand the comments and the evidence which the committee has received on these matters. I believe the provisions which we've created in the bill provide judges with sufficient flexibility around when they should issue direction to the jury. It's worth keeping in mind as well is that there are other times when judges issue directions to juries as well, particularly if there's been expert evidence, etc. Led. I don't believe that this is interfering with the judiciary in a way that compromises their independence. I think the provisions in the bill provide sufficient flexibility for them in being able to give direction as when it's necessary and to give them a level of flexibility in how that's put to the jury.
You've mentioned expert evidence being led. That seems to me a perfect way around it. You know, you have someone explaining these points, that it isn't always the case, and that if there's a delay in reporting, that this indicates a false claim, and the expert evidence explaining that, then if there's some judicial direction, then that seems quite reasonable. But to do it without that expert evidence doesn't.
Well, you know, expert evidence will be, will be taken in many cases in issues, and it's worth. And at that time, obviously, if expert evidence is actually taken, then clearly the judge will consider giving some direction to the jury. But it may not always be the case that there will be expert evidence. But I think it's important that we ensure that in these types of particular types of cases, given when particular type of evidence is led and issues are raised in it, that we have a provision in place that ensures that judges give direction to the jury. Now, it may be that some judges are already giving some aspects of direction to juries on these matters, and some may choose not to. My view is I think we should put it on a statutory footing, so we're very clear about when that should be provided, but give the judges the flexibility to put that to the jury in a way that they consider most appropriate.
You've mentioned that expert evidence may be led. We got a very clear steer both from the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service and from Lord Calloway that the cost of providing expert evidence would be prohibitive, and therefore there would be a very real possibility that that would not be led and that would be replaced instead with statutory jury directions, which no one seems very happy with. Lord Calloway did mention the option of something being within judicial knowledge. Also raised is the possibility of putting guidance in the form or mentioning it simply under the model directions contained in the Scottish Jury Manual. Are these kind of compromises, if you like, or adjustments that could be looked at to the provision in order to safeguard the very real concern about compromising the independence of the judiciary and setting a precedence?
Look, the first thing I think to be very clear here is that the bill doesn't do anything that affects the ability for expert evidence to be taken forward in a case. And it may be that if the Crown choose to introduce expert evidence in relation to a particular case, say, for example, if it relates to a lack of physical force when a rape's been carried out, the bill doesn't affect in any way that from happening. And it may be that a combination of expert evidence and jury direction will sit alongside one another, but in no way inhibits that or prevents that from happening at all. So the bill doesn't make any provision to prevent expert evidence from being led or changes that in any way.
So you've no concerns that cost would come into this in the slightest? In fact,
cost in what way?
The cost of providing an expert witness, which seems to me the way around this. And there you are, the witness giving the evidence that because something is delayed in reporting, because someone hasn't used force, because of all these things, then experience tells us, we have sound evidence. All of that sounds to me the very best way to do it. But what has been mentioned as a barrier to using that expert evidence is the cost of providing it. So it's out there, it's been raised, and I think it would be unwise to just dismiss it and say that, well, if we need an expert witness, they will automatically be they will be brought in when there's such problems and concerns about budgets.
Well, no, the point I'm making is that this bill doesn't change anything around a decision to bring in an expert witness on a particular issue in a case. And if the suggestion is that we're introducing this because in some way it's less costly, it's simply not the case. This is about making sure that we take forward an area which we've identified, and as you'll be aware, many stakeholders are supportive of, particularly those who work with victims of these particular types of crimes, that there is a need to make sure that juries have a clear understanding of some of the issues around evidence that may be led in the course of a particular trial. But the jury directions are very restricted to several areas. Should those issues be raised in the course of the trial, and there's sufficient flexibility in there that if it's not in a context that requires jury direction, then the judge isn't required to give jury direction.
So you're quite confident that if this provision is introduced, then there won't be calls to have similar provisions for other perceived misconceptions?
Well, you know, Parliament in the past has taken a view around areas of the law which we believe require specific measures to be taken forward. An issue around sexual offences, particularly around rape trial matters, were an area where it was identified that there were concerns around certain potentially preconceived ideas or views about particular aspects of evidence that can be led in a trial, whether there was resistance, whether there was a delay in reporting, which could have an impact on the jury without proper understanding of those circumstances. And part of the reason behind making provision for jury direction is to help to address that particular issue. It's not unique, as I say, in that jury directions are given in other areas by judges which have developed over the years, and there are other jurisdictions within the world that have jury directions in these particular areas around sexual offences.
in order to help to address the particular issues that can arise around these types of crimes.
Lord Calloway covered that point, and he acknowledged that while it did exist in other jurisdictions, it was far from ideal. So perhaps at stage two, the Cabinet Secretary may reflect on that. Is there a possibility that you will look at some of the evidence we've taken from academics, from the judiciary?
Well, look, I'll look at all of the evidence and consider all of the views that have been considered on this issue, but we're very clear in terms of our position around jury direction. And as I will, you know, I've already considered the evidence which you received from Lord Calloway and other members in your roundtable discussion with them when they attended the committee. I'm also very mindful of the victims' organisations who are very supportive of jury directions as well. We considered many of these issues in drafting the bill, we came to the view that jury directions were an appropriate route for us to go down, and that's why we've brought it forward within this particular piece of legislation. So, but of course, we'll always look at the evidence which the committee receives, and also, of course, the Justice Committee's stage one report. But there are a number of issues which have been highlighted by witnesses who are not in favour of jury directions are issues which we did consider prior to the drafting of this bill.
John.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, if the issues of delay in telling people and the physical resistance or the absence thereof are widely acknowledged, and they seem to be, why would the Faculty of Advocates and Law Societies not support the approach that you're suggesting?
Well, it's not for me to answer on behalf of the faculty
like
or the law. Well, I don't think it'd be fair for me to speculate on what their views are on why that is. I think it's better that the Faculty for Advocates and the Law Society explain their position to you, as I believe they already have in their view. We believe this is an appropriate measure in order to try and help to address some of the issues we have around these types of cases being before our courts. For some of us, I'm sure for many members of the committee, this is not a new issue. It has been flagged up for a considerable number of years in the way in which these areas can be played out during the course of a trial. And concerns have been expressed in the past about the need to address this issue much more effectively. And going back to the point that was made by Margaret Mitch around this is an issue that may be within judicial knowledge, that may be the case as well. I'm not aware, though, over recent years, of clear action being taken to ensure that these issues are properly addressed. And I believe that that lack of innovation it merits the introduction of this statutory provision in order to address what has been a long-standing issue of concern for many organisations that work particularly with women who experience these types of offences, in order to make sure that there's clearer direction given to the jury when particular issues are raised in the course of the trial.
If you saw Lord Calloway's evidence, you'd know that he was very open, both with myself and my colleague Alison McInnes, about a particular case that we'd both had concerns about. He was also very diplomatic, because he clearly didn't want to say, but there was a right, let me own the statement, I sensed he resented political interference and independence of the judiciary. Would you think that was a reasonable summary of his position?
Well, this is an issue for Parliament to consider. And if we as a Parliament consider that there is merit and justification in applying jury directions in statute that can be applied in certain circumstances, then I believe that's a reasonable course of action for us to take in order to deal with particular issues within our justice system. You know, Parliament makes decisions that have an impact on the judiciary on a regular basis in various matters. I don't believe that this is political interference in a way that is directing a judge on what they should say or shouldn't say. What it does is it sets down the criteria, as in certain circumstances, if these issues are raised it's appropriate, then there's sufficient flexibility there for the judge to choose to issue jury direction
and to do so in a way that they believe is most appropriate to the circumstances that they've heard before them. It doesn't specify what they have to say. That gives them sufficient flexibility for them to be able to do that, reflecting on the evidence that they've heard before the committee when they are charging the jury.
The position that my colleague Margaret Mitchell talked about with the Crown leading an expert witness, is that not more inherently fair to the accused, because it gives the accused representative the opportunity to cross-examine, which clearly they won't have if it's a judge's direction?
But as I say, the bill makes no provision that would actually stop the leading of expert evidence as well. And so it doesn't alter that. And it may very well be that where you have an expert evidence led, that there will also be a jury direction offered that as well. So I think it's it's important that we give enough flexibility to the judiciary to make sure that what they are saying, to the direction they are giving to the jury, reflects the circumstances that they have heard and the evidence that's been led at that particular trial. And that's what the bill makes provision for. It gives them sufficient flexibility to be able to do that.
The Law Society talk about unfairness if this provision is exclusively to relate to sexual offences. Indeed, and we'll not linger on it, but they give the example of corroboration applying or not applying to some particular cases. Is the Scottish Government so concerned about using the word victim with the frequency it does that there's a danger that it's setting aside hard-fought for rights that accused people rightly have?
I think that's why we've tried to give a balance to this in terms of the limited circumstances as and when, as you'll be aware, within the bill that sets down when jury direction should be issued, but also giving sufficient flexibility to the judge to determine whether that's necessary, depending on what they've heard before the actual before the court itself, and also in what that specific direction is then to the and how they put that specific direction to the jury. So we have sought to make sure that we provide a balance to give them sufficient flexibility, while at the same time to address an area where there has been concern for some time around how certain information can be presented in court and how that can then have an impact on the trial.
Yeah, thank you. Finally, Cabinet Secretary, what assessment, if any, has been made about the likely increase in appeals against conviction as a result of the introduction of this? Were it to go ahead?
It's very difficult to assess that type of thing and how many appeals there may actually be as a result of any change in legislation, because the appeals could be for a whole variety of means as well. It's not something that you can realistically project prior to a piece of legislation being implemented.
But it's not unrealistic to say that that's a factor that you could anticipate. It's an additional factor that could be the subject of an appeal.
A piece of legislation could come in and defence may seek as a result an appeal as a result of the direction that's been issued by a judge. That could happen. But it's very difficult to quantify exactly how many cases may actually come across or may come about as a result of that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Gail, then followed by Roderick.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think it's fair to say, Cabinet Secretary, that there is some research in regards to how juries react to cases of rape, but it's very sparing indeed. However, I think it's with regards to the Contempt of Court Act in 1981 prohibiting research being carried out with real live jurors. However, Professors Vanessa Munro and Louise Ellison conducted a study using mock jurors. That showed that jurors expected particular reactions by rape victims. They expected visible display of emotion, and normal would be to struggle physically. And the two professors said, which sums up their study, overall, while jurors in the no education trials paid lip service to the notion that different people will react differently to traumatic experiences such as rape, assumptions regarding the instincts to fight back, the compulsion to report immediately, and the inability to control one's emotions continue to influence deliberations. And I know that this very much is in line with concerns expressed over many, many years by women's groups that jurors in rape trials are influenced by their own prejudices and preconcerned notions of how people react in these trials. So I'm wondering what this will do to overcome these prejudices.
Well, part of the research which Gil Patton's referred to has highlighted some of the issues around concerns about some of the preconceived ideals and views that jurors can have in these particular types of offences, which was part of the reason why we have gone down this particular route around looking at making a statutory provision in particular sets of circumstances where the judge will be required to give jury direction on these matters in order to address these types of issues much more effectively and to make sure that the some of the research that the member made reference to, that some of these misconceived or preconceived ideals and issues can be much more effectively addressed prior to the jury, at the time when the jury are being charged. So the jury directions are a very specific way in which we can address the issues that Gil Patterson's highlighted, both from the research and also from the victims' organisations who have been raising this issue for some time now.
Maybe I should have declared an interest. I'm a former member of a board member of Rape Crisis, and common currency within that fraternity was the notion that the trial didn't proceed or it failed on the basis that the jury itself had preconceived ideas, as I've already expressed, that they should, that people should react in a particular fashion if they had been raped, particularly at the trial, and they should you know, notionally show these emotions in a way that's predictable. So therefore, you know, if that is the case, is there not a need for wider education? Is there not a need for not just this bill being in place for jury and jury directions being in place? Is there not need a need for wider education, some money spent to highlight these points that people do react differently? And for instance, in the trade that I'm in, the motor trade, and I know this from personal experience, if somebody has a bump in their car and they turn up to a reception area to get the car repaired, some people, including men, can be very, very emotional, and some people are very calm about it. So people react in all different ways. And I think it would be, I think it, the government should consider, well, would the government consider an education programme to highlight how people react in different circumstances?
I think, you know, I'm happy to look at that further and to explore that further. It's very difficult to do anything around jury aspects as well because of the Contempt of Court Act. And as the committee will be aware from a previous appearance at it on the Lord Bonamy's report, is that we are looking at taking forward jury research into some wider aspects around how our juries operate. And that approach will be largely based on academic experience from elsewhere, where they've been able to undertaking this type of research in other places. Can I just say that, you know, in our earlier session there, when I was being asked about the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service demands on the system, and John Finney raised the very issue around the historical cases as well, and we have an increasing number of historical cases being reported. Now, the fact that it may not have been reported in recent times doesn't actually mean that the offence didn't take place. There can be a whole range of circumstances that could lead to that. So I think it's important that we don't lose sight of what we're trying to achieve here, and that is, it's not to try and create an advantage for the defence or a disadvantage for the accused. It's to make sure that some of the underlying research that we know that indicates that people can enter into these types of issues with some misconceived ideas around some of these particular issues, around timing, etc., of when they were reported, and for the judge where that becomes an issue within the actual trial to also be able to issue direction to the jury to be able to explain is that the fact that there was a delay, it doesn't mean the offence didn't take place. And that delay wasn't necessarily material to their decision making on this matter. So, but I'm more than happy to look at the issue around what further education would look like, and given you know Gil Patterson's own personal interest in this issue over many years, I'd be more than happy to discuss that with you further.
One of the questions I posed to Lord Calloway was if not regarding rape, but if a juror had indicated some prejudice, what reaction would it be? And I think I don't want to actually put words in his mouth, but I think he said he would take action on that juror, and yet it would seem that jurors, quite a section of a jury, would have prejudice automatically before a trial starts. So my question would be, it's not this not about preferring one against the other? This is about a level playing field and educating a jury itself. Is this not what it's about, educating a jury that people don't all react in the same fashion if they have been seriously assaulted in a sexual fashion?
Well, it's to make sure that the jury have an understanding on whether evidence has been led in some specific areas as is set down in the legislation, for the judge to make an assessment as to whether he feels that they are it's relevant to the point that he should give some direction to the jury on the matter. And for him to then offer that direction to the jury to say it's not unusual for judges to give some direction to juries on particular issues, but in this case it is specifically related to a sexual crime in a way that is very specific about the type of information that may be brought before the court during the course of that trial. So it's to assist the jury in understanding that information rather than trying to give any one particular side an advantage over the other.
Thanks very much.
But Roderick and then Christian, and then we must move on to the rest of the bill.
Thank you, Convener. Perhaps I can pull together some of the threads that have been talked about in the last three questions. Firstly, on the question of whether expert evidence would be suitable, I think, if I recall, Professor Jarmers pointed out in his evidence session that the law currently only provides for expert evidence on delayed disclosure of reporting. It doesn't provide for expert evidence on the absence of physical resistance during the act itself. So clearly that wouldn't be a panacea without changes elsewhere in the law. As to Mr. Finney's point about the Faculty of Advocates view, I hesitate, notwithstanding I'm a member of the Faculty of Advocates, to speak for them, but Mr. Meehan made the point that if mandatory directions are to be given on one matter, there never to be requests for them to be considered across the board. The difficulty is, in the absence of jury research, one does not really know whether the jury would find that helpful. Gil Patterson's referred to the jury research carried out by Professor Munro. I don't think any of that has been specific to this jurisdiction. Given that there's a possibility of jury research being carried out under the auspices of Lord Bonamy's review group, wouldn't it be prudent to take account of that research, either if this legislation is passed, perhaps not having a commencement date for these provisions until that jury research has reported? Is that something the government would consider?
I'm not necessarily persuaded that's necessary because of the level of understanding we have in this area at the present moment. Additionally, the jury research it will take a considerable period of time. It's not a short piece of work, and the outcomes from that will take a considerable period of time to then evaluate and to come to a decision on whether there are further changes that we want to make within our justice system. And I think I'm due to appear at the committee in a few weeks again, which I think will be and an issue that's related again to aspects of jury research. But I think we have a, given the level of understanding we have in this particular issue, at this particular point, I'm of the view that there is sufficient evidence to justify moving forward towards the statute jury directions in a very restricted, limited set of circumstances, but which gives sufficient flexibility to the judge in when they apply and how they also put that across to the jury.
Thank you.
Thank you, Judge. I just wanted, talking about jury direction around sexual offences, and we talked about precedent early on about in other jurisdiction. Is there, do the Cabinet Secretary or his official knows any precedents in other jurisdiction where that type of jury direction has been expanded to other cases than sexual offences cases?
Beyond sexual offences cases, yes. And so having started with sexual offences cases, that's then grown to other areas. Off the top of my head, I'm not aware, but I'm more than happy to take that away, and we can check, and we can then come back to the committee if that would be helpful.
But what would be interesting, and another point, I heard Gil Paterson talking, and you talked yourself about perceived ideas, but I referred to the policy memorandum, the key information, and when the words are stronger, concern have been expressed by certain ill-founded preconceptions held by members of the public who make up juries about the nature of sexual violence, make understanding victims' response to such crimes more difficult. So, you know, it's a condemnation of how we are as a society and how we see. So we heard a lot of evidence which says that it's maybe not the way to do it. But if we want to update to make sure that society and juries are following this kind of directions, will maybe a reassurance to all these people who are complaining if you could maybe have a review of this kind of jury directions and maybe seeing them abolished in a certain time, you know, in 5, 10, 20 years' time, once society hasn't got these misconceptions anymore.
So I think, on the, you know, although there are views out there from some parties that this is not the way to do it, I'm not necessarily persuaded that I've heard of a very clear example of I've actually got a better way in which you can deal with this issue. And also I'm mindful of the length of time that this issue has been around and concerns about it have been around without clear concerted action being taken to address it effectively, which is why I believe that lack of innovation merits statutory provision being made in this particular area. In relation to reviewing any provisions within the bill, and in particular this specific provisions within it, there is obviously the route for post-legislative scrutiny of a piece of legislation and how it's operating as well. You know, I'm always open to, I'm very conscious that this is a very busy committee, which probably limits the opportunity that you have to carry out post-legislative scrutiny. Another option would be is to commission some research at a later date once they've been implemented to see how it's operating as well. There are various means by which that could be operating. I'd be interested in the committee's views on that, where they feel that would be something that they feel would be useful. And if it's something which, you know, I can I feel that from the government's perspective we could agree to, I'd be more than happy to consider that. But I'd be interested in hearing the committee's views on what you feel might be a useful way of establishing that at some point once the legislation's been introduced.
Thank you for this, Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Can we now move on to section two? If I can invite questions, maybe not quite as many questions as we had on the previous section, but if I can invite questions on section two, Margaret McDougall. Anybody else interested in section two? Okay, Margaret.
Right, thank you, convener. On the non-consensual sharing of private intimate images, we heard from witnesses who gave evidence that they felt it should be widened and you know, there should be all different kinds of communication should be included, like text messages and letters. So what are your views on that?
Well, we've gone for a slightly wider definition than applies in other parts of the UK in this area, where it's slightly more narrow. And I'm conscious this is a clear example of the type of emerging type of issue that comes about through social media and making sure that our law is as up to date as possible and be able to deal with these issues as effectively. And I'm also very conscious of the written evidence that you've received around whether we could widen the scope of the definition of this offence further to around private and intimate text messages, emails, voice mails and letters. We're going to give consideration to that. There is a balance to be struck here, though, as well, if we widen it further, the potential unintended consequences that the legislation could then have as well. So I'm not, in my mind, set against it. I just, we need to explore this very carefully so that we do not find ourselves in a situation where we widen the definition to such an extent that we create a lot of unintended consequences that would not have been our objective as well. And I'll, of course, be interested in the committee's views on this matter, but I think there's a balance to be struck by widening it and also potentially drawing into the offence areas that it was not initially intended for.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I welcome the fact that you are going to look at that again, but Victim Support Scotland and Women's Aid in particular felt, and they argued that it should not matter what the media is, it is the non-consensual sharing or the threat to share sensitive and intimate material which is designed to humiliate and control or cause distress to the victims. So, and Scottish Women's Aid pointed out that sometimes images and abusive texts are sent at the same time. Now, you know, you could say, Scottish Government, that such texts may be captured by other legislation, but Women's Aid were concerned that by not including other forms of communication in this specific offence may create an unnecessary loophole in the law. So are you going to take all of that into consideration when you're looking at this again?
Yeah, well, just to be clear, we're not looking at it again as in are we going to do it or not. What we're going to do is look at whether, consider the evidence that you've received and also the committee's report. What we will do is, if there is, you know, I'm open to where if there is reasonable scope to widen out the definition without, as I say, having significant unintended consequences around what we're trying to achieve with this, I'm open to considering that. The other thing is that we need to make sure that the definition that we set in the legislation is also very clear and as clear as possible in order to make sure that we get the maximum benefit from it. That we don't dilute it to the point that it starts to become, well, does it cover that issue, but it doesn't cover this. If we widen out too far, again, there could be that potential to create some confusion around that matter. And as you've already mentioned as well, there are other pieces of legislation which can be used for some of the areas that have also been highlighted to the committee. But I can give the member and the committee an assurance that we are going to consider these issues and if there is reasonable action we can take, I'm more than willing to do so. And of course, I'll also be mindful of waiting to hear from the committee's views on this matter before we come to a final decision on any potential widening of a definition at stage 2 or 3.
Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the technology allows these things now. For example, a text could be sent and then a screenshot taken of that text, which then becomes an image. So, you know, how do you define that then, and should it be included? So
But it's just worth keeping in mind, in the bill we do set down some issues around the nature of the images and what would be involved in the images as well, which would be, again, be slightly different from a text message.
Yeah, but if we want to widen it to include text messages, we should take that into account. I mean, also there's the issue around sexting, which lots of young people are involved in nowadays, where, you know, they send and receive sexually explicit images or videos. Now, that perhaps, if that was included, would incriminate young people, and obviously there is a concern around that, but at the same time, we need to get them to realise just the implications of what they're doing here, because, okay, they can send these text images, but they finish up on a pornographic site because someone has picked or been crashed into somebody else's computer or whatever. So what is going to be done around that, around the educating of younger people, so that, you know, to try and stop them from messaging like that?
So when I mentioned earlier on, I think that's one of the things we have to be careful here, for example, around sexting. And is there intention to potentially bring in a lot of teenagers into our criminal justice system as a result of something like that? Or is that an area which is more appropriately addressed through education and promoting safety programmes around using technology amongst young people? And we provided guidance to local authorities and others back in November 2013, which was around some of these issues. Now, it may be that there is further work that needs to be undertaken in this area, but this is an area where I think we need to be careful on whether our objective is to bring all of these potential teenagers within our criminal justice system, or is this an area which would be better addressed through wider and better education and understanding of it? And that's where I'll be interested in the committee's views on that matter, but that's where my judgment is in this matter, that I would be concerned about unnecessarily bringing a lot of teenagers within our criminal justice system, when it may be that there was a more reasonable route that could be taken in order to try and address this issue much more effectively. It's not just about educating people about not doing it, it's also educating people about what they should do if it does happen to them, and how to prevent it from occurring in the first place. So it may be an area that lends itself more to education and to bring it within the criminal justice system.
And responsibility as well, obviously, because
of course
we need to instill that in our young people. Around it, social media, you know, Facebook, and sometimes these images finish up on social media. The responsibility of these sites in taking down photographs that are inappropriate, there's no time scale at the moment. Would you have any intentions of including that, so that there was a specific time laid on these sites, so that they would have to take down an inappropriate image or that was there by non-consent?
Well, there are certain liabilities which internet providers have. Part of the challenge you have here is that those internet service providers may not be based in Scotland. They may be completely out with their jurisdiction. I suspect the vast majority of these types of service providers are based out with their jurisdiction. You're then in a situation where you wouldn't be able to take legal action as a result of that matter. I think there is certainly more that the EU could do in terms of the way in which service providers respond to these types of issues, which would strike me as being a much more effective way to try and address this rather than individual cases in themselves, and to look at whether there are further provisions that could be applied at an EU level to address some of these timeframes around that. There is already some aspects of EU law in this area around issues relating to intimate images. etc., and fear for it to be taken down when they're notified, etc., can have an implication for them. But I it would be very difficult within this legislation to start tackling something which is completely with their direct jurisdiction.
Okay, so would there be any plans to look at this in the future or to raise this through the EU?
Well, yeah, well, it would be fair to say that there are some, there are areas to which are reserved, so which are out with their competence. It's an area which I know the EU have already provided some legal provisions on, so there are, there is a course that could be taken, a course of action that could be taken through that with a provider, but it would be difficult for us to do anything further within this legislation. As I say, given that many of these issues would be, many of these service providers will be out with their jurisdiction.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I invite members to any other areas of the bill, of this, the other sections, if members have any questions on other sections of the bill now? Alison.
The final section relating to section 6 relating to sexual harm prevention orders, we had some concerns about the fact that these orders could be imposed on an individual who has not committed a criminal offence of any kind. Do you think that there's equity in that, and should there be some safeguards which make it clear that if this is about to be imposed, that the person against whom the order is going to be made would have the right to make oral representations in advance of it being implemented?
So this is the concern that the offence may have been committed somewhere in the UK.
No, it's not. It's the sexual harm prevention order, so the right. final section, section 6. And just in relation to that, these sexual risk orders in particular can be imposed on someone who has not committed an offence, so it's a lower level of
there's no offence has been committed.
It's really around about the equity of that. People have raised concerns about the equity of doing that.
So I understand the concern members raised in regarding that, and that it's the civil burden of proof which will apply in these issues, and that no offence has to have been conducted. The principal objective of these orders is prevention, and it will be obviously for a sheriff to consider the application based on information that's presented before them as to where they believe that burden of proof has been sufficiently demonstrated to justify that an order should actually be issued. There is, of course, a recourse to that in terms of of course, the judiciary have to make sure that the way in which they're applying that is compliant with ECHR, and how they then conduct that in the court and how that's taken forward, and whether someone then chooses to appeal against any decision on that. So there is a right of recourse should someone choose to do so, if they wish to pursue the matter once a sexual harm prevention order has been applied. But their primary objective is preventative in nature, which is the intention behind them.
So would you consider the bill's currently silent, as we say, on whether there's a right of representation in advance of the order being laid? Would you reconsider that in order to be fully compliant with ECHR?
Well, I'm not persuaded that it's not compliant with ECHR, and that's an issue which obviously a sheriff would have to consider at the time and how they are going to proceed with it based on the information that's presented before them in considering these issues. And of course, there is an issue of recourse as well. So, you know, I'm always mindful if there's ways in which we can improve the way in which it's operating. I'm not of the view that they're not compliant with ECHR, so long as that process has been appropriately applied by the sheriff that's considering the issue.
So could you clarify, is it open to the sheriff to allow oral representation?
The sheriff can make, let's see, they can go have, the offender will have an oral hearing in the form of a plea and mitigation in the matter. So, it will, however, be for the
sexual harm prevention order can be granted in civil proceedings, and which is different, again, obviously, from the SRO. But so they can have an oral hearing if they consider that to be appropriate.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Thank you, Camille.
Okay.
Can I say just a brief point? I don't want to get too bogged down in to this, but if you may recall the evidence sessions we had on the 17th of November, we took some evidence from Professor Chalmers on the drafting of sections, subsection 8 of the proposed new section 54A. I think Professor Chalmers was suggesting that there might be merit in removing the words "or who has subsequently become" in reference to habitual residence. Is that, without going to bog down too much in the technicalities, is that something the government will take on board, the comments that Professor Chalmers has made?
I'm aware of the concerns which he's raised. I think the slight issue we have here, I think it's largely a theoretical point rather than it being a practical issue, because I'm not aware of any significant difference between sexual offences law in Scotland and other parts of the UK. So something that would be an offence in England that wouldn't be an offence here. So I'm not aware of that. So, but what we will do is at stage two we'll give consideration how we can, if there's a way in which we can clarify this much more effectively in the legislation. But I do think it's largely a theoretical point rather than actually being a practical issue in itself, because we haven't been able to identify any difference within the different jurisdictions on sexual offences legislation.
Thank you.
Margaret. Yes, just finally, section one. The statutory abrogation would apply where a person either intends to or is reckless as to causing a partner or an ex-partner physical or psychological harm. But there's no requirement for proof of previous similar acts, of a previous similar act. And I think the concern, therefore, is that the aggravation could be libelled in practically every case involving physical or psychological harm against a partner or an ex-partner. Is that the intention behind Section 1?
It is.
It is, okay. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the Scottish Government is currently thinking about a specific offence of domestic abuse. Why was the decision not taken to include this specific offence of domestic abuse in the bill?
Well, as you were, we've already started consulting on the specific offence around domestic abuse. The purpose behind the aggravator was to make sure that it was formally recorded by the court at that particular point. And it was recognised at the time of sentencing an offender. It's in a similar approach which we've taken in other areas of the law, for example, around religious and racial hatred matters. And we believe that by providing a specific aggravator, it provides reassurance to victims that it will be formally taken into account at the time when the facts of the offence are being considered, and that it will be considered by the court at that point. So the purpose behind it is to ensure that it's formally recorded and recognised by the courts. Okay.
Thanks. Well, just finally, with respect to Section 5 and the non-harassment orders, there are some concerns raised whether or not that's, if somebody has been assessed by court as being unfit to stand trial, they could still be subject to a non-harassment order. If they breach that, it's a criminal offence, but they may still be unfit to stand trial. So it's a bit circular that you might not really be achieving very much by that.
I think the challenge we have here is that you can have someone who's not considered to be fit for trial, but that there can be an ongoing issue with the harassment, stalking, etc., still taking place. And the purpose behind this particular order is to provide a mechanism which can be put in place in order to ensure that it also provides clarity to the police that they can take action should the order be breached.
And it provides greater reassurance then to the victims of these types of matters. Now, there could be issues that circumstances may change by the time they are presented before the courts again, where they could be prosecuted, but it provides us with, it provides the police in particular with clarity around enforcement of these matters should an order like this be in place, despite the fact that the person may actually not have been fit for trial previously.
Thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. And thanks for your attendance at a rather long session this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to suspend very briefly to allow the clerk to see which of the petitioners are actually here today for item six. Obviously, we'd be keen to make sure that we attend to those particular... Okay, thank you. Right, thank you. Can we restart given the we have a number of petitions to be considered, which the clerk has produced a paper, number six, to accompany this item, and some of the petitions may not be considered again. In fact, if we get through all of them, we may not consider any further petitions in this session. However, we have a number of them, and as the petitioners on 1370 on an inquiry into the conviction of Magrahi are present, I would like to take that petition first, and then we'll return to the other petitions. An update from Justice for Magrahi was circulated to members on the 18th of December. The update again emphasises their position in relation to the appointment of an independent prosecutor to consider the findings on the police investigation Operation Sandalwood. The clerk's petition, a clerk's paper reminds members that the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission announced in November that it was closing its review of Magrahi's conviction because it could not get access to his defence papers. And therefore, can I have members' views on the petition? But possible options are set out in pages 9 and 10 of the petition, so I can take views from members.
Yep, thank you, Convener. Well, Operation Sandwood has been alluded to, and that certainly ensured that the accusations made by Justice for Magrahi were back in track, and I know that they have every confidence in the way Police Scotland have dealt with that, and indeed they praised it. And I think, given that that's live, first and foremost, the petition must be kept open, would be my view. But there are wider issues, and these have been alluded to, and I don't think any criticism could be laid at the door of Justice for Magrahi Committee about the timing of the voluminous amount of papers that we got today. They do also relate to the time frame of exchanges, and not least with the Lord Advocate. There's a significant issue about process here that I think should be of concern to the Justice Committee regarding the administration of our criminal justice system. In this particular case, we know there was 9 criminal allegations, and I know that we're going over ground we've gone over before, but I think it's important we do that. And it's important to say these have been made by highly respected public figures. Stress this is about process, and I think it's to the Lord Advocate's credit that he recognised that there was a conflict by the appointment of the independent counsel. We then have the situation where quite reasonable questions have been posed in a letter initially, on the 24th of August last year, subsequently on the 5th of November, by the committee to the Lord Advocate. and these questions remain unanswered. I have to say that the issue of process for me isn't exclusive to this case. We need to try and understand what would happen in the event of a criminal case where the people charged with making important decisions themselves are the subject of some accusations. And as I say, it's to the Lord Advocate's credit that he's acknowledged that. This is about process, it is about postholders, it's certainly not about personalities. But having accepted that Operation Sandwood has put the issue firmly on track after an unfortunate start, we do have the suggestion that the Crown agent is an independent person in this process, or will play a role in this process. And as we've seen from the letters, and hopefully members had the opportunity to read them, certainly, you know, I think any reasonable judgment would say that that's not necessarily the case, given that the Crown agent defended the Crown Office's position on this in a letter of 2012. As I say, the time frame's out with the control of the petitioners here. I think there is a broader issue that goes beyond the petition, so I would like to suggest that Committee A keep the petition open. Excuse me. But also, I think it's entirely legitimate, and indeed the public would expect that we would want to understand the significant issue of a possible gap in our process there. And I would like the clerk to write to the Lord Advocate with the particular questions. Hopefully we'll get some response to them that would advise what further action, if any, we would need to take.
Can I seek other Roddy?
I'm quite happy to keep the petition open, Operation Sandwood's ongoing, and obviously it's a little bit disappointing in some respects that the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission have taken the stance they have done, but I fully understand why they've done so. What does concern me is some of the recent correspondence, which seems to focus far too much, in my opinion, on one individual whose role is to coordinate matters with the Independent Counsel. And I'm not sure that I could agree with Mr. Finney on what questions we should actually be addressing the Lord Advocate, but I would like to reserve my position on that to actually see what it is it's proposed to address to the Lord Advocate.
John Finney raises important issues of process, and I think he's right to highlight that it's not about individuals but about the process, and I would support what John has suggested doing.
I mean, there was a suggestion here about a letter. I wonder, one of the possibilities, so it wasn't, doesn't indicate that it's a committee's view necessarily, would be to ask the Lord Advocate to respond to the recent paper from Justice for McGrath, which obviously, through no fault of their own, was not delivered to members until fairly recently.
I certainly wouldn't have a problem with that. And then obviously the committee can consider this again.
Yeah, and we can keep the petition open and ask for response, Christine.
Yeah, I would definitely be happy with your recommendation, Convener, particularly that our Convener have particular views on the things as well. So I think if you want to keep it as neutral as possible and making sure that we take cognizance of the letter we received and asking for explanations, we will be glad.
So we will keep the petition open. We'll ask the Lord Advocate for his response to the points made by Justice for McGrath and their recent contribution to us. Okay. Thank you very much, and thank you to the petitioners for their attendance yet again today. Thank you. Can we then return to the other petitions? The petition 1280 on fatal accident inquiries, we kept this petition open until the inquiries into fatal accidents and sudden deaths, etc. Scotland Bill had been passed. Stage 3 of that bill was concluded on the 10th of December, and the bill, as passed, included Section 6 on inquiries into deaths occurring abroad, which we set out in the paper on page 3 that we received. During an earlier evidence session, the petitioner appeared to be broadly content with the relevant provisions contained within the bill. As the clerk's petition also notes, there was an amendment agreed to at Stage 2 that allows for fatal accidents into deaths abroad to be carried out even when the body has not been repatriated, which was one of the recommendations of the committee. Does the committee agree that this petition could now be closed? Agreed. Good. PE1501 and PE1567 on investigation into unascertained deaths, suicide and fatal accidents. Petition PE1501 requests that inquiries be held where death is determined to be self-inflicted or accidental following suspicious death investigations. PE1567 asks for a change in the law and procedures in the investigations of ascertained death, suicides and fatal accidents. We're taking these petitions together because they appear to be making similar requests. In both cases, the petitions have come from family members of a person who has died suddenly and were not satisfied with the way in which the death was investigated. The clerk received a communication from the petition 1567 petitioner in late December, and this has been circulated to you, and I must say it is a heart-rending description of a death of a young man, which, you know, I have every sympathy for, and I'm sure the whole committee does, for the mother of that young man. Last time we looked at these petitions, we agreed to write to the Lord Advocate. We asked him to for additional information regarding the safeguards that are currently in place to ensure that investigations into deaths by the police or the Procurator Fiscal reach robust and sound conclusions. We also asked what powers families have to question the outcome of such an investigation. The Lord Advocate's response is attached in Annex A, and that to some extent reiterates information we have already received. It also includes reference to the new Charter for Bereaved Families, which sets out the different stages of an investigation process and confirms what information will be provided to bereaved families and when. Page 4 of the Lord Advocate's letter also outlines the review and complaints process that are open to bereaved families disappointed with the investigation. This is not the more formal process that the petitions appear to be asking for, and the Lord Advocate makes it clear he is not contemplating any major legal changes in this area. So can I have the members' views on these petitions, possible options, as set out on page 7 of the clerk's paper? Colleagues. Christian.
Yeah. I wonder if the rest of the committee agree if there will be a last ditch, if I can use those words, and maybe write to the Cabinet Secretary and asking if there are any other reassurances that we've not heard before, which will maybe help us on this, particularly regarding the validity of a police investigation and decision by the COP.
Mm. Any other views? Is that agreeable to the rest of the committee that we do?
I don't know if it is.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll keep the petition open and write to the Cabinet Secretary for any other assurances. And obviously some of these other petitions, if they're still open, they could form part of our legacy paper at the end of the session if there's still issues arising from that. Thanks, colleagues. And PE 1370, PE 1479 on the legal profession on the illegal aid time bar. Petitioner is asking that the time bar for making complaints against the legal profession be removed completely. The Scottish Legal Complaints Commission has planned to increase the time bar from 1 to 3 years, but the process has now been delayed while the SLCC consults on the issue as part of a wider consultation. A copy of the SLCC's most recent correspondence with the committee is reproduced at Annex E, so therefore can I ask for members' views on that? So this petition, possible options are set out on pages 11 and 12 of the clerk's papers. So can I seek views as to how we take this forward? Or?
I'm no longer of the view that there is really much merit in keeping this petition open. It seems to be slightly technical that the situation hasn't been resolved, and appreciate we're back to the consultation phase of SLCC, but I'm not actually sure. I mean, it's undoubtedly going to change at some point, that keeping the petition open is actually serving a useful purpose.
Yeah. I tend to be of a similar view to yourself on that, Roddy, but John.
Likewise, Convener, can I also suggest that we encourage active responses to the consultation?
But the consultation even isn't likely to address what this particular petitioner is wanting anyway. So. Okay, so we agree to close this petition? Thank you. PE 1510 on the closure of police, fire and non-emergency centres north of Dundee. Clark's paper discusses this petition along with PE 1511. Since the committee's last consideration of the petition for the subcommittee has taken evidence from Her Majesty's Inspector of Constabulary for Scotland on his final report on call handling, what Mr Penman has to say is set out on page 14 of the clerk's paper. And can I have members' views on petition PE 1510, possible options being set out on page 13? confused. John.
Convener, I'd be keen to keep this position petition open. I think it's a very much alive matter. I know there's different interpretations of the outcome of the HMCIC's report. I certainly took it as vindicating the retention of the control rooms, but I think it's still part of an ongoing process, and I would hope that there would be a decision taken to retain them. But I think it'd be appropriate to keep it open given the ongoing events.
I just mentioned PE 1511 as well on closure of the fire and rescue control room in Inverness. Members will recall that the issues highlighted in the petition were raised during our evidence session with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, Fire Inspector and Fire Brigades Union on the 28th of April last year. And can I have other members on both, maybe members' views on both petitions as to whether or not we keep those both open, or one open and not the other open?
I agree with John that we should keep P1510 open anyway at the present time. I'm less sure about wanting to keep P111 open. 1511.
Yeah, okay.
You know, we've previously sought assurances from the fire service about petition PE1511, and while we've had some assurances, we've heard during the budget process some concerns about the impacts of these closures, and I would keep both of them open at the moment.
Sufficient. Not going to the ditch over it.
Yeah. Okay, we'll agree to keep both of them. Just in terms of, is there anything further that we want to do with PE 1511, or we just want to keep it open at the moment in case we?
Just keep it open.
Just keep it open. Not take any further action. Okay. That's great. Thank you very much. And our final item today before we go into private session is the subordinate legislation. And I think we've more or less caught up with our timetable now. This is the Management of Offenders, etc. Scotland Act 2005, Commencement Number 8 and Consequential Provisions Order 2015. This instrument was intended to commence the remaining provisions of the 2005 Act and to extend the multi-agency public protection arrangements beyond registered sex offenders and restricted patients to include certain high-risk offenders. As you can see, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has drawn the instrument to the Parliament's attention. Its main concern was that it was laid under the wrong procedure, negative instead of affirmative. The Scottish Government has acknowledged this and has laid two replacement instruments. DPLR Committee had a further concern that the Scottish Government should have formally revoked the instrument. The Scottish Government considered that this was not necessary. All this is set out in some detail in the Clerk's paper. Just before the end of the year, the Minister for Parliamentary Business wrote to the DPLR Committee. The Justice Committee was copied into the letter, which has been forwarded to members. The letter essentially restates the Scottish Government's view that no further action on the instrument is necessary. This instrument has been put on the agenda because the advice the convener received was that it was necessary to do so under standing orders. However, despite the continuing disagreement between the Scottish Government and the DPLR Committee, both sides agree the instrument is not law and will not become law. Replacement instruments have been laid and will come to this committee in due course, at which point we can consider the issues of policy rather than procedure. My suggestion is that we make no recommendation on the instrument.
Agreed.
Good.
It's pretty rich that we've got such a mix-up about this.
Oh, yes.
It really, really is unfortunate and quite unacceptable, I think.
Oh, yes, I think, I don't think we have any comments on the instrument in terms of procedure, but it does seem fairly remiss of the government to submit an order of this under the wrong procedure. Okay, that concludes the public part of the meeting, and I would ask members of the public to leave. Thank you very much.